name is Vinod, and I'll talk about Swordfish JavaScript. We'll talk about a JavaScript library which we developed to talk to a Swordfish server. And I'll tell you the reason behind it, why we want to do it, and the method we used. I'm not sure how many of you know the company I work for. That is, it doesn't sell storage. I mean, we don't sell storage, but we help our customers to build their storage products. So most of the storage OEMs, if you pick, we work with them, and we help them to build their storage product, and especially the manageability side. So the request that comes to us is, okay, we have a Swordfish backend, and we have a storage management application now. Can you use that application to talk to us for Swordfish backend? Right. So now when we looked at that, every time if you want to build this, say, a web-based management application, it has to know this Swordfish schema, the resource, the layout, and then use that in a viewable mechanism, right, in your JavaScript or AngularJS or something. So we thought, why don't we build a reusable JavaScript library which knows what the schema and layout of Swordfish and Redfish is, and then that will get downloaded onto your web page, and most of the processing happens in that layer. And then what the real application developer gets is a JavaScript object. So he doesn't see a JSON object or a storage object. He gets a JavaScript object, say volume. So you want to say, target a device and say get volume. It goes and gets all the volume, and all the protocol communication is unwrapped underneath the library. So that's what we built. And that helps us because when we want to go to n different customers and they want to use their Swordfish backend implementation and have that integrated with their application, this helps us very easily. So that's the whole idea of the star topic. And I thought I'll put some context as to that manageability at hyperscale, why it's important, and what all problems that we had, Redfish, Swordfish. I won't go through the details because the last two, three, four sessions, I think we are talking about that, so I'll probably skip those fast. A look inside Swordfish, the usage model, and then we'll talk about the JavaScript library, like how we went about developing it, how the resource modeling is done, and how we use the backend mechanism to get the data. And then some of the learnings, right? I mean, some of the learnings that we had. I had a demo which will actually talk to a web browser, which will talk to our Swordfish emulator, and then get the data. Unfortunately, the laptop is not compatible. I won't even show a demo, but we can talk about that. So manageability at hyperscale, right? I mean, most of the data centers, if you look at today, they have that hyperscale infrastructure, right? Which is a combination of heterogeneous servers, storage, and network components. Like, nobody is now logged into a particular vendor. You have storage from vendor X, server from vendor Y, network from somebody else. Or in terms of hyper-convergence, you have everything in one box, right? Now, how do you manage this efficiently, right? Now, you don't want that different set of tools or products for storage, a different set for server, and different set for networking. So the convergence in the appliances or the hyper-convergence or the, that is not really reflected in the manageability yet. Because when we do that end-to-end appliance development for our customers, we see that they have different pieces and we have to combine them to work together to give a single pane of management class to the end administrator. Now, the Swordfish, Redfish combo makes that very easy because you have the same interface which you can talk to a storage backend or a server backend. So that's why we thought it is more suitable for that hyperscale hardware. And what we need is performance, reliability, and security, right? I mean, these are mostly talked in the data path, but even manageability path has the same issues, right? Because we have worked with systems where after, let's say, 32, 33 nodes, when you add on their virtual scalable infrastructure, every volume creation takes extra 2 minutes. So that's the kind of performance we're talking about. And similarly, we worked on a sandbox from the customer where after, let's say, 220 shares, every share, new share being added takes about a minute. So that's the kind of performance challenge people are facing when they scale, right? So now, that's the important part. And then how do you model a multi-vendor environment? How can you model a multi-vendor environment where compute, storage, network come from different hardware vendors? So that is the whole idea behind solving this problem. So solving a web scale manageability problem, that needs a web interface, right? Because if you look at internet is the best reliable web scale architecture we have seen. So if you have to manage a server or a data center which is web scale, I think it's better to use that web protocol interface as well, right? And then we also need to be less chatty, because most of the management protocols are chatty because it needs multiple command response interaction to get what you are actually trying to achieve. Now, what if you can get more data from a single transaction? So the number of back and forth response request pattern can be avoided. That's one protocol, less chatty. So you get more information in fewer transactions. And then common set of APIs, RESTful APIs, which is common set so that everybody can use it. And internet standards and tools, like since the tool chains are same, it helps the administrator to use that and manage them effectively. So that's the beauty of this. So choices are, which all the protocol to use, right? Use well-known protocol, most commonly heard CRUD semantics, like the create, read, update, delete. Make the discovery easy, like, I mean, unlike SMIS or WebM protocol, that discovering the topology of your target hardware, right? I mean, that is pretty hard at this point, but hopefully the Swordfish, Redfish implementation makes it easy. I mean, I'll talk about that as well. And primarily out of band. I think most of the manageability communications are today out of band. I think Redfish also is talking about in-band host interface option, but I'm not sure it is there yet. But predominantly, it is out of band, and easily extensible. I mean, you should be able to extend the features, right, from a vendor-specific feature. That's about easily extensible. And you should support compute, network, and storage. As I talked about the hyper-convergence, right? I mean, the manageability protocol should support both SANE's compute, network, and storage. So that's the whole idea. So having said that, so why I said the hyperscale and the simplicity and the performance requirement, I just talk about Redfish and then get into Swordfish. I think mostly it is well known now. I think we have been talking about it since morning, so I won't go into the details of it. Basically, it is REST plus HTTPS and JSON, right? That is the technology flavors that's being used. And HTTP methods are used for a protocol for common CRUD operations. And a Redfish interface is exposed through a web service endpoint, and anybody can query using that standard known service route, right? From there, he can actually explore the entire system. And it uses the Hypermedia API, which is a small set of defined URIs, right? You have very small set of defined URIs, which says, okay, slash Redfish slash V1, that is the service route. And from there, you can explore the entire system. And from every level, you can get information about it. With the links, additional links, you can get the information about what is out there, right? So that improves that discovery. So that's the whole idea about the Hypermedia APIs, what Redfish provides. A bit more detail for a detailed understanding, like a client talking to a Redfish server. It uses HTTPS, and the response comes as a JSON object, and the client has to process. Right. So our problem is here. Right. I mean, when a JSON object comes to your client, the client has to do a little bit of understanding of what is that object and how to represent it in the management application. So this is what our library is going to fix or going to help. Now, the protocols are common set, and Redfish is using RESTful, a common model, and extensible. And let me go to the next slide, which talks more about the features. Like, I think George already talked about this OData convention, that schema is modeled using OData. The resources are modeled using CSDL, the simple schema definition language. And this is getting translated to JSON when you want to send it over to the client. And it's model oriented because there's no tight interaction. It's not like a SOAP based transaction. So there's no tight interaction between the client and server. The client can change while server is same, or the model, the protocol and model, there's no tight interaction so that they can change asynchronously. And it supports sync and async operations. Like, I mean, most of the operations are synchronous where you get a response back, but then there are some time consuming operations. It can support the async operation as well. So you send out a command and the command will come back with a 202 error code, and then you can query that and using the task ID, and then once the task is completed, you get 200 responses in each time. So it supports the asynchronous operation. Event support, which we are using a lot in our implementation, that is when there is a time critical event or an event happens on the target hardware, how can the management application know that, okay, something has failed on this target system, right? So you can subscribe for a certain event channel, so, and then you can poll on the event channel. So if there's any event happens, there will be a HTTP post notification onto the client, and client can process that. So that's another one. And then action support, like reset operation, where you want to do specific action on the target. So these are some of the Redfish features, and then since Swordfish is mostly implemented on top of Redfish as an extension, all this applies there as well. So as I said, I mean, we are using especially the event support and async features in our implementation. Now Swordfish, it's a storage model over Redfish. So it's an extension of Redfish to support storage, a model for scalable storage and associated data services. So it's not only storage services, it also extends the data services, because most of the people talk about data service, like, I mean, storage as a service. So how do you expose the data service to customers and how do you manage them? Storage services like snapshots, replication, mapping, masking, and provisioning, and wide range of storage, like, I mean, from small drive to your scale out file system. So it should be, the schema should be able to support all that. And I think that's already built into this layout. I think we already seen it a couple of times how the extension works. So the bottom one is the Redfish schema, and then the extension is the blue one, which is talking about storage services, a storage system, right? And then each of the storage services have an indexed based on the system ID or UID of the particular service. And then each of the, for example, a storage service can have a volume, shares, or replicas, and a volume can have storage pool. Storage pool can have volumes, volume can have disks. So that association also is maintained. So that's about a data model. I think we have seen that enough, so probably I'll skip that. Now, so given this context, our problem here is, I mean, when we are building the management application for every customer, we have to go through this entire JSON processing, understand the target or the response, and then implement that as an application object, right? So now how do we make the life easy for the application developers, especially the website, the SRM developers, so that they don't always have to do the deep sea fishing, right? I mean, they can sail on the top, take a look at that horizon, take a look at the rainbow, right? So they don't have to worry about the deep sea fishing. So how do you abstract all the Swordfish complexity, or how do you abstract this nuances from the story SRM developer? That's our focus, right? So if you look at any storage management software, finally what it needs to do is it needs to convert certain business goals to a specific actions, right, which actually goes and modify your storage box in terms of provisioning, in terms of managing, monitoring, all this stuff. And the common tasks are like configuration, provisioning, event and log management, performance assessment, like if you have a specific IOPS or specific SLA given target, to ensure that the SLAs are maintained. Diagnostic support, fault detection and remediation, and accounting and resource consumption. How do you actually look at the billing and metering of your resource, especially in a storage, a cloud storage model? So basically, to achieve all these, your management application should talk Swordfish, right? I mean, if the backend is supporting Swordfish, the frontend also should be aware of it. Now, how do we make that less painful for the application developers? What was our task? So the goal of SwordfishJS is
provide an easy way to access Redfish or Swordfish resources within a JavaScript client. I mean, we started with JavaScript because most of our customer applications were using JavaScript, and we can easily use this in the AngularJS framework as well. And sort of JavaScript APIs that wraps this get, patch, put, post, delete verbs of this HTTP, of REST, and you give user consumable objects, right, in JavaScript, and provide a predefined set of JSON objects directly used by the application, right? So that the application developer's task is very easy, right? When he wants to get a volume or a set of volumes, he just makes a JavaScript call, say get volume, and our library actually packages all that, sends a Redfish Swordfish request, get the response back, decouple the response from the protocol elements, create a JavaScript object and give it to application. So he can cache it, he can store it, he can use that for his management application. That's the whole thing. So the goal is abstract the complexity of the protocol from the application developers, leverage existing JavaScript model, because if you look at OData processing, there's already OData.js, right? I mean, so you don't have to do that heavy lifting of finding out what's the best to use. We will give the libraries. Now, all this will be part of your system, and then as part of any web interface, these libraries will be pulled onto your browser. It'll be running as a browser. It's running on your browser as a thin layer, and that handles all that protocol conversion.
What's the licensing terms for OData.js?
It's free. It is free.
BSD,
free license. Okay,
3-class BSD.
Correct.
Okay, thanks.
So that's what we use. So the basic idea is that, how do you abstract this and give an easily packaged instance? But again, the developer has to understand some amount of, okay, what is the storage, what is the volume, so that he can use those APIs. And then we also give certain verbs. So I think that is in our next slide. Probably I'll go there in a bit. So this is a simplified view of that diagram. So for example, if you have a JavaScript client here, there's an object model which we build, and that is this as part of the library, and that has most of the storage objects that you can think of, like a system, logs, file, shares, volume, snapshot, drive. Now, this will be populated based on our Swordfish, Redfish interaction with the backend server, and this is facilitated by the library and including that component. So we built our own Redfish wrapper in JavaScript, a Swordfish wrapper in JavaScript, and this easily indexable JS library to cache them. So that is a model here.
How far down in the tree do you create objects, or do you flatten
them? We flatten their thing. We kind of aggregate, right, because you don't want the application guy to know the deep, as I said, sailing in deep sea is required for the protocol guys, but not for the application guys. So we just kind of aggregated them, flattened them, and said, this is object you can use, and we'll be able to get everything by them. Say, for example, if you want to get a storage pool, he just makes a storage pool request, and we use the Swordfish API to get a storage pool. And once the get response comes back, we create a storage pool object, and that JavaScript object is there for the application to use, so that he can use that for all the purpose within his client application. Like some of the interactions, let's say, for example, how we are converting, like say if it's a pool, you do a get or get storage pool, so you get a list of storage pool from the backend server. And if you want to create a volume, then we send another request, so it actually goes through that Swordfish Redfish interface, goes to the server, and comes back. So this layer is what we build and we cache. This object pool is what we cache. And then we use that event mechanism. For example, we can also subscribe, right? I mean, if you get a disk, whenever we get a disk or a component which can fail, we also do a subscription, so that any event on happening on that, we can get a notification, and then we can update our cache. So that's the model. So an example of what all the flattened object that we kind of created in the JavaScript library, and what all the APIs that we expose to the a developer, right? So for example, we have storage system, storage pool, right? So now a storage pool, we give APIs like get storage pool, and that will go and do the entire heavy lifting and creating an object. And then you can have a create storage pool, delete storage pool, update storage pool, all that operations. And these are the high level wrappers that we created, which actually Swordfish protocol elements. Same.
You've only picked certain properties to expose to your API.
Correct.
And so, for example, vendor extensions won't appear in your API.
If there is a vendor extension, we have to add extra code here because
as it's static. You're not building them based on what you find. You're building them on code that's used to fetch them.
We are building. So once the object comes in, we go through the properties and then we build the object based on that.
Right. But if you're selling a new one, you're not going to add it to your API dynamically.
If I understood you right, you're looking at the metadata, description of the object.
Correct.
And then building.
Yes, on using that. So it's dynamic, it's not static.
So let's say Redfish comes out with V2.
Uh-huh.
Would you work with it without change?
The library might need change if there is an extra metadata which we don't understand. But yeah, but
so you need to understand everything.
He needs to understand when you're talking about the metadata. In this case, metadata gets used for lots of different things. Mm-hmm. So when you say the metadata that you don't understand, you're talking about an annotation you don't understand, or you're talking about
properties.
Properties.
Properties. So you understand the difference between name, status, capacity.
Yeah.
You understand those.
Correct. We understand.
Not from the metadata description. Those name and description are simply string.
Correct. Because that intelligence has to go a little bit right, so that the user finally knows what to use. Right. I mean, if you want to show, I create a picture of volume. And then I say this is 80% full, he has to understand, okay, the capacity.
Correct.
So now that level of understanding is required. Now, the question I thought is, if there's an extra, it's an add-on feature which Redfish put, now how do we know that, whether we have to expose to the end user or not, that we need to make some change. Right.
So the dynamic approach would discover all the objects, and then add those to your API on the fly, and then it would be up to the application, the new application, whether he wants to use those new properties or not.
Yeah, could be, true.
So you're not really programming against Redfish, you're programming against your API, which was based on a version of Redfish.
No, we have a Swordfish, say for example.
Swordfish.
So these are some of the sample objects that we have now. I think there are more. I just put some for the simplicity of it. So drive, snapshot, replica. And basically, we looked at what all the information that an application would need, and how do you package it and give it to him, and how do you abstract the complexity underneath. That was the idea. And to what we have today and way forward, so we have a fully compliant API library which works with Redfish wrapper. And
how do you determine compliance?
So we ran it with all the tests that we have, right? I mean, we have these tested across three different implementations of Redfish, and then it works, right?
So you're validating
our validation.
That's some external.
So what we've done is we took a third party, I mean, I can't name the client product, we use that, and then we put the library underneath, and then the application will give the same behavior, right, for an administrator.
Yeah. So the most you can say is
correct. Because the compliance is not a plex-fest validated compliance, right? Yeah. So the, this was a little slightly old, so support for event-based object state update, that is in place now. The support for actions on a task and objects that's in place now. So I had a demo of this, but since the
laptop.
Yeah, the laptop is old, so when I talk about demos, so the demo is we're using a Gromit-based application so that
you can use that and then pull all the JS library onto the application and then talk to a server. And then the demo was supposed to show you how can you query the pools on a backend system and then create a volume, right? And you pull out the existing volume, show their statistics, create a new volume, and then show it. And then I think there was one on the event handling, especially when you create a policy saying, when I have the volume is 100% or 90% full, send me an alert. And then we can show that as a different sign in that application. So unfortunately, I can't show it.
What IDEs do you support? That being Eclipse?
We tried with Eclipse, so yeah. but since it's purely a JavaScript library, it works anyway. I mean, with any IDE, should be. I mean,
now we're talking about developing what's above that.
Yeah, but that, yeah. Again, if my client application is any of the JS variants, right, it can use.
Okay.
Yeah. So there's no strict affinity to any IDE that in that sense, but the language affinity is there. I mean, it should be a JS variant, right?
But you mentioned Grump as well.
Yeah, Grump, right. I mean, we use that because that is what our customer asked, so we use that to start with. Okay. Some of the learnings and shortcomings, so as I said, mapping the high-level storage resources to Swordfish schema. So that is one of the stuff that we learned the schema well and then found out how do we package and abstract so that you can give that required information to the application? That's one thing. Aggregation, how do you flatten the stuff, right, from a deep-rooted schema? And the discovery process by navigating the get response from service route, how do you actually get a topology of your hardware? Handling async operations as a special case so that you can update the cache, object cache. And some of the issues that we found is, that I'm sure all the people are here, there's no direct way to identify snapshot volumes. I mean, our problem was, if you have a volume and there's a snapshot policy created, there's no easy way to find out which all the snapshots are associated with volume. So current schema or the version we looked at didn't have that mechanism.
Did you look through replication info?
Yeah. So what we found is there's a separate list of snapshot volume schema, but there's no mapping. So
from a source
volume to a replicated
replica,
volume. Yeah.
You should be able to go through the replica info complex type within volume.
Okay.
To locate the snaps.
Okay. And
we got rid of associations when we moved to Redfish.
But now we are trying to rebuild that here.
It's just not an association class. It's
okay.
It's a navigation property.
Okay. So
it's in the replicated phone.
We'll try that, but I don't remember that seeing that. Maybe is it in any updated one or we looked at it almost. Okay, sure.
Schema.
Sure.
The one thing I might have thrown you off is the connection, and if I recall correctly, is to a resource or even to an item, resource item, I forget, to make it much more general.
Okay.
So you can replicate whatever.
Whatever, okay. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's the confusion we have.
Okay. Found what you were looking for.
Okay, yeah. And second is performance. I don't, yeah. We looked hard, but we couldn't find. But if it's there, we'll be happy. Yeah, now, second one is the availability of performance statistics. So we really want to show that dashboard right now. I'm not sure, is it in pipe or is it going to come?
We've added some stuff. I think it's been approved to add. We've added some. There needs to be more added.
Okay.
So feedback on that would be
because what we need is we want to show a dashboard, right, from a share perspective, like how many how many operations are being performed.
We added it recently to volume, but it needs to be also added share. To pool and to share and all those other things.
Having you look at what's there and telling us if we got everything would be welcome. Like
sure.
The first question here, of course, is what performance stats do you want?
This is the same thing, like from a share operation perspective, how many
operation.
I think we've got the basics covered. But
okay. So you guys are just your SNIA member, right?
Yeah.
So we just need to get you GitHub access. You can file these issues directly.
Sure, okay.
And
Sure. So those are the kind of stuff we found. And then very less diagnostic action support. I think even Redfish has the same problem. I think there's no diagnostic access because like most of the admin, right, you want to say, okay, do this action on my NIC card and tell me what happened. So now there's no such primitive. So that's another problem that we found because the most of that management application needs that one-click action, right? So now that is missing. So that's another one. That's all I had, and sorry for the not having the demo. Yeah, question.
So, is this on GitHub?
So far, not. It is on our local repository. We are going to put it. I mean, we are going to put it as an open source project.
And then under what license?
It can be free license. I mean, it will be a
BSD license. Free license. Okay, that's very compatible with SNIA.
Right.
And then, how would we change your API other than a contribution of code, obviously?
I mean, if you want to say, okay.
Who governs the code? Who governs the API? Maybe you want to have a standards group govern the API.
That would be good too, right? Yeah. Because, I mean, our thing is, this was only conceived as a need for us. Now, if there is a requirement that wider acceptance, then yeah, certainly we can do that. We are going to put it out anyway as an open source.
SNIA has a bunch of open source stuff. If you bring this into SNIA, right, then it'll be in the SNIA repository.
Sure.
And you'll get a lot more users than you would if it was sitting out there in the WIP repository.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, sorry.
And then when our members want to add a new property that you're not using so far, mm-hmm. they can just go and contribute the code,
certainly.
Right?
Yeah. Certainly we'll do that.
Yeah.
I'll work. Any other questions? Nope.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.